Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good to see you here. We've got nice sunshine. I'm standing in the sun. You're standing in the shade. And listen, we're outside. We took a bit of a risk, okay? If you find the chairs slowly sinking down, especially the back legs, and you find yourself slowly like lying backwards, then just jump yourself up, pull your chair out, and then move it somewhere else, and you'll be fine. I was like, we need to be outside, even though it's a little bit soft underfoot. But I'm good. I'm on the concrete, so this is good. Everybody picked up a bulletin and your communion pack. Well, there's always one, isn't there, Jim?
Thank you.
Bulletins, communion packs, if you need those.
They took Will to the hospital, like Friday or Saturday, when I was there.
Okay.
And I don't know how she is.
Okay, thanks.
That's our little lady. We leave our bags over there.
Oh,
right over here. Oh, yeah. Lil and Mary.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Will. The two Lils, I'm just checking. There is, it's interesting being in this location here. There were two ladies over there, Lil and Mary, and often we as a church sort of have connection with them various ways. But sometimes you'll see during the church service, one of them will put their chair out there. I'm never sure whether it's Mary or Lil to listen to the service. But apparently Lil, for those of you who know Mary and Lil was taken to the hospital on Friday. So be remembering her in your prayers. We get a couple of announcements, and then we'll begin. My name's Martin Corns. I'm the pastor here at Gloria Day. It's good to see everybody here who didn't rush off to the state fair today and get some of that lovely food. Fried pickles. Salvation Army. So I've talked about this before. We're collecting for Salvation Army, and initially it was the back-to-school items that our local Salvation Army collects. But we are going to help them now. They have this school project, after-school project, that runs through the year. And they would love us to just collect items through the year, really. So once those sales start at Target or wherever it is, because everybody else has gone back to school, grab some items, and then we can really bless some of the kids that come along to their after-school project. Dollar store, a lot of places, yeah. Once kids are back to school, suddenly the prices go down. So wait until then.
Yeah,
wait
they're
until
out
then.
Right now. They've been a couple
of
days.
Oh, sales are in now.
Yeah.
Valaine, our local marketing expert, also a local treat expert. Apparently today we're having Mardi Gras treat. Mardi cake.
It won $25,000 at the Pillsbury Grand Prix.
Valaine's treat won $25,000. I'll take the $25,000. You guys take the treats. Rally Day is the 12th of September, so a couple of weeks' time. We'll have a service here afterwards. We're going to have a potluck at, it's going to be at my house, which is about 25 minutes south of here. But you're all welcome along. If you want to bring something, then there's a sign up just inside there. You don't have to bring anything. Just love to see lots of people coming along to that. You can bring people along to it as well. It'll be good. Last thing, for Rally Day, and then going into next year, we're going to be looking at Mark's Gospel. Now, if you've got a Bible and you've got Mark's Gospel in it, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you want to start reading that, do that. But from next week and the week after, we've got some Mark's Gospels that we've prepared for you, places for you to write your notes, highlight, draw on, scribble on as well. Because I'm going to be encouraging everybody as we use it on a Sunday for our sermons, on a Wednesday for our Bible study, to be really interacting with the Bible, trying to hear more about what Jesus has done for us. Ushers needed for September, that's my last note. So if you are an usher, if you'd like to be an usher, we need some for September. If you want to know more, then talk to Carmen about it. We're going to begin our service this morning. Just invite you to be quiet for a few moments. Recognize that we've come into God's presence. God is here in his house, in creation, as we come to worship him. God, the creator of this beautiful world, around about us. But we know that often when we come along on a Sunday, there are so many things going through our mind that we get distracted. So I'd invite you in the quietness to ask the Lord to help you to focus on Him this next hour or so. Father God, thank you for bringing us along to church today. Father God, thank you that we've got the opportunity to hear from you through your word. We've got the opportunity to receive from you through the sacrament. Jesus, we are reminded of your sacrifice for each one of us. Thank you that we can have fellowship together as well with our brothers and sisters. We pray that you may bless this time. Use it to draw us closer to you and build us up in our faith. We pray for your Holy Spirit to come and speak to us now. Bless this time, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so our worship this morning begins in the way our lives in Christ in baptism began. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to listen to a song that Carmen's going to bring us, and then move on with our service. And as you listen to this song, listen to the words of it, very powerful song, and allow the Lord to speak to us.
What did Lord Jesus say in the good book today? Put a little love in your heart. Let His Spirit grow, please let the world to know. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will know about God's grace, and the world will be a better place for you and me. Just you wait and see. Think of your fellow man, lend him a helping hand, put a little love in your heart. You see it's getting late, oh please don't hesitate, put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place, and the world will be a better place for you. And me, just you wait and see. Another day goes by and still the children cry. Put a little love in your heart. You want the world to know we won't let hatred grow. Put a little love in your heart. And the world will be a better place, and the world will be a better place for you and me. You just wait and see. Take a good look around. If you put someone down, put a little love in your heart. I hope when you decide, let kindness be your guide. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will know about God's grace, and the world will be a better place for you and me. Just you wait and see.
Thank you, Carmen. So this morning, we're really thinking about the two greatest commandments, love God and love other people. And some people say, well, that's very law-orientated. Where's the gospel in that? But I think we know that if we're called to love God, it's in response to the fact that love, that God first loved us. And our response to that, out of joy, out of thankfulness to God, is to then turn around and love other people, love our neighbors. We're going to find out in our reading later on that the challenge is, who is our neighbor? Who is our neighbor? Who is the one that we're being called to? And as we're going to see in the parable, it's not the one that we expect. But we recognize that when we're called to love God and love others, we fall short of that. So in our confession, we're going to go through parts of Scripture and turn that into our confession together, recognizing that we have sinned and fallen short. So on page 3 in the bulletin, it goes on to page 4, so you need your finger in it. I'm going to read the L parts, if you can read the C parts with me. Let's turn to confess our sins to God. So hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength.
These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts.
Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Blessed is the one who considers the poor. In the day of trouble, the Lord delivers him. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. And who is my neighbor? And who is my neighbor? They may not be beaten down or lying by the road, but there are people we pass by watching God.
Some are family and friends we take so much for granted. We cannot see how we have stripped them of our love and compassion.
Others are neighbors who have been left half dead by crushing words, who have fallen into the hands of despair, who have been abandoned by all those who walk unbinded. Many are strangers, people we don't know,
but quickly judge.
They are weak,
or poor,
or the enemy,
or because they remind us of who we once were, or could become.
Rescue us from the power of our selfish sins, righteous one of all generations.
Pour out your justice on us, rather than your judgment.
That we would be moved with pity and spurred to action.
That we would hear of the hope that is ours and share it with our sisters and brothers.
That we would shower mercy on all we meet, even as we have received forgiveness for our sins
through Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior.
Brothers and sisters, as we have come in confession, and as we're going to hear more later on about that struggle with loving God and loving others, we recognize the gospel, the good news in that, that we love because God first loved us by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross, to rise again, to bring us forgiveness, to bring us that joy, that hope, that peace in our lives. So through our confession, may we hear that those words today, that because of what Jesus has done for us, it is that that means that I can declare to each one of us that our sins are forgiven. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to sing again, Love Divine, or Love's Excelling. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together.
Fix in us.
your seats a moment. Verlaine's going to bring us two readings. The first one is Psalm 32. It's a psalm of David, a psalm of confession. And then we're going to move on to Galatians, a reading from Galatians. And Paul is going to tell us that there's still a place for the law. We know that the law is a mirror, that we can see ourselves and we can see the sin in our life. And now the law is a rule to guide our lives as Christians. It's not something that we have to follow because Christ has won the victory for us. But the law is a guide for us as we walk through life. And we're going to hear then about that in our gospel reading. Elaine.
The Old Testament lesson is written in Psalm 32. Blessed are the forgiven. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through all my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at this time, when you may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed by bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is written in Galatians 3, verses 15 to 22. The law and the promise. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made and was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promise of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Belaine. Come to the gospel reading, which I'm going to have us stay seated for. The gospel reading is a parable that Jesus has told us. And it's a parable that probably you've heard many times before. But the challenge for us this morning is to actually hear what it says. Hear who is doing the helping and who is being helped. So the Holy Gospel according to Luke chapter 10. Glory to you, O Lord. So Jesus, turning to the disciples, said privately, "Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings desired to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put Jesus to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, What is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and where he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these 3 do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, The one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, You go and do likewise. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. For our message, we're going to sing again, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. We're talking about loving God and loving others. And this is a reminder of John 3:16, that it's God who loved us first. Will you join me as we stand together if you're able to?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that left him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life, I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have made my ransom.
Thank you. Please take your seats a moment. As we come to hear God's word this morning, will you pray with me? Father God, thank you for the privilege to open up your word, Lord God. Your words to each one of us. Lord God, I pray that you may fill us, fill this place with your Holy Spirit. Give us hearts open to hear from you. And Lord God, to be challenged by you as we hear those words, go and do likewise. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So last week we had a beauty contest with our feet, and I think we decided that I'd lost. But never mind, I'm not embarrassed about my feet. I just keep them covered up all the time. We're talking about how our feet last week are used to share the good news of Jesus Christ, to share his love, his hope, his joy, and his peace. And we're going to continue that theme again today a little bit. 10 years ago, myself, my family moved back, or well, my wife moved back, but we moved to the United States. And for Rachel, she'd been living in England for 20 years as an American citizen living in England. So she was moving back. My kids are dual citizens. But for myself, it was, I was going to get a permanent resident visa. So in order to do that, I had to make a couple of trips to the London embassy, the London American embassy. That was an interesting experience. And there's a vast amount of paperwork you have to do. There's a lot of cash that changes hands. There are medical checks that have to be taken place, bank statements they want to see, references, the whole lot. And I wasn't actually becoming a US citizen, I was just getting an American permanent resident status card. Now, I bought my passport, well, actually this is my old passport. I was getting stopped so many times that I got it changed early on. It's got so many stamps and other things in it. And sometimes when you go from one country to the other, they don't like to see different visas of countries in there. But I brought it along because inside it is my green card, which actually is now, I've got to get a new one. But whenever I leave the country, I've got to have this with me, which then allows me to come back in. So this is, when people talk about a green card, this is what it is. It's sort of green, you know. Very, very important card. And of course, I suddenly realized the other day when it clocked up on Facebook, you've been here 10 years, I was thinking, that means my green card has run out. So of course, I've got to go on the internet, fill in all these forms, pay my $540, and then just be told, well, it's in process to see whether you're eligible for one. So if I'm not here next week, then you know. And, you know, I choose to have a visa rather than become an American citizen. I can talk to you about that afterwards. But anyway, the point is, I moved to America. We spoke English. My wife's family lived here. We had somewhere to stay initially. I had money in the bank, although no credit rating. That's another big issue. If you ever want to move here and you don't have a credit rating. I had a reasonable education. I got a job pretty quickly. We got a car. We were able to drive here. For some reason, you all drive on the wrong side of the road, but I managed to dodge out of your way, and then we're okay. And we sort of got used to the Minnesota weather. That took a while, but we got there, okay? And we decided to move. We weren't running away from war or torture or anything like that. But we know, looking at the news, at the minute, there are places across the world that for people's own safety, they have to leave. They have to leave. And they're very thankful to come to the United States. And they're very grateful when people help them as new immigrants. People help them maybe with English language. People help them with all those forms that they've got to fill in. We're just trying to get a bank account, trying to get medical insurance, trying to find somewhere to stay, trying to sign the kids up for school and realizing they don't even know what chickenpox vaccine is, let alone knowing what chickenpox is. A lot of different things. When people come to the country, they've got to try and work it out. You imagine going to a store, looking for all those foods that are familiar to you and finding nothing is familiar. These different challenges that you might have. And as I said, you know, we know in a couple of months' time, well, maybe a month's time, Minnesota gets cold. And then you're suddenly realizing, oh, I've got to buy clothes that will cope with Minnesota winter, never been in a Minnesota winter before. And maybe, I suppose it's a bit like a situation. Imagine you're a Vikings fan. and you suddenly find yourself surrounded by Green Bay Packer fans. Maybe that's the closest we get to it, okay? You suddenly find that in your street, around about, people change, people move, people leave. And the people that are around about you, just are different. It's a different situation, different culture. It's a lot of immigrants coming in. When we first moved here, went through that similar sort of situation. And if you look at our passage, it's a story, a parable that we've heard many times before. We loved acting it out with Sunday school classes. But I want us to notice one thing. It's probably a little bit flipped around from what we actually think it is. And maybe it's obvious, right? But it's the stranger, it's the foreigner, is the one who helps the one who is local. It's the person who's new into the country who's suddenly taking us to the store and showing us what we need to buy, etc. And not just helping, but putting themselves at risk, at harm from the same bandits, spending their own money to help the person who is injured. And the challenge then at the end of that passage, go and do likewise, Jesus says. Loving our neighbors comes down to treating others the way we want to be treated. James, the book of James. James tells us in chapter 2, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or a sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, be warm and fed, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is it, that? So also by faith itself, if it does not have works, is dead. That's a really challenging passage from James. You know, how can we say we love God, who we not see, if we're not actually loving our neighbors who are right there around about us? I wonder, what would we have to change about ourselves if we were going to truly focus on loving our neighbors as ourselves? Now, that command, and we've heard about it a couple of times in our service today, that command to love our neighbors isn't just a New Testament thing. You can go into the Old Testament and it's right there. So everybody knew that command. Go back to Leviticus, Deuteronomy. When a foreigner lives with you in your land, do not ill-treat them. The stranger living with you must be treated as one of your own. And Moses, in that passage, then reminds the people as well. He says, and you know for yourselves about this, because remember, you were once living as strangers, as foreigners, in the land of Egypt. And Jesus continues these commandments, saying the stranger is also a neighbor, even though they may not share the same background, the same culture, or even the same religion. Now, just remember the geography of the story that Jesus is telling us about. Most pilgrims, say if you're going from Galilee, and we talked about this, we've got the map, but we haven't got it in front of us here. See if you can get a picture of it. They go from Galilee, and they just head east to the Jordan Valley, and they travel south until they get to Jericho, and then they go west again to Jerusalem. And a lot of people would do that trip. But even though a lot of people did it, that trip still had some challenges. I've shown you pictures before. I don't know whether you can click through your memory and trying to get some of those pictures. That last bit from Jericho to Jerusalem is really quite mountainous. It's a challenging area to walk on. It's hot, it's exposed. There are plenty of places for people to be hanging out. And if you're, especially if you're by yourself, you're an easy target for the bandits that are waiting there. And so the teacher of the law, he asked Jesus this question, and he wanted to justify himself. He was probably really good at looking after his Jewish neighbors around about him. We are probably really good at looking after those people around us that we like to look after. But he wanted to give himself a pat on the back. He wanted to justify himself. And so when Jesus tells this story, where you've got this priest and this Levite, and they wanted to stay pure. Maybe they were heading from Jericho into Jerusalem. They were going to the temple. They knew if they touched a dead body, if they touched blood, well, that's it for 7 days. That's their pilgrimage ruined. And the teacher of the law would be the same. So when he heard this, he's thinking, you know what? Yeah, I quite agree. Pass by on the other side. What's wrong with that? I'm just fulfilling the law. But not fulfilling God's law of love. The teacher would have passed by. But he's going to leave the Jesus challenge feeling really quite dejected. He was really good at showing love to those people around about him. But maybe not so good at showing love to the one that Jesus was challenging him to show love to. The way Jesus calls each one of us to show love to other people, to live out that good news of hope and joy and peace, which we know for ourselves, and which it's selfish not to give away. So look who Jesus says in the parable, did actually reach out to the man who had been beaten and left for dead, a Samaritan. And we've talked before, so remember this, don't just say, oh, he's a Samaritan, he's a Jew. Remember how we've talked before, how the Jews and the Samaritans, they weren't just foreigners. They were enemies together. They hated each other for good reason. We talked about the history of that and why there is that issue between them. And as we read this parable today, we might feel, you know what, there are good reasons why there are some people I don't like. There are good reasons why maybe I shouldn't be helping those people. And yet Jesus tells this parable about the good Samaritan. And people are listening and they're going, what an oxymoron. The people thought, you can't be good and be a Samaritan. That is not possible. And yet there's a challenge in this passage. The Samaritan risked everything, risked his life, his money, his time to help a traditional enemy. Now imagine that there's a sort of a double shock going on in this passage as well. Jesus not only calls the Samaritan the Jew's neighbor, but he also asks the teacher of the law to follow the Samaritan's example. The Samaritan now suddenly becomes the teacher. Go and do likewise. The Samaritan becomes the teacher. He becomes the role model of love for this man, this teacher of the law, to learn from. And we know for ourselves, Jesus didn't just speak this parable. He's not just not speaking the words. Jesus himself lived the life. He reached out to us, even though we were enemies. Even though we were steeped in sin, Christ laid down his life for each one of us. And he's now our role model of love for us to follow and live by. Now, I know that we know that if you look around the Twin Cities, there is a huge diversity of ethnic groups. The Twin Cities is one of the most ethnically diverse places in the world, in the country. If you go down to the Phillips neighborhood, apparently they've got, I don't know how many, tens, even 100 different ethnic minority groups just within that small area. We've got Ethiopians, Somalis, Liberians, people from India, from Vietnam, from China, from Afghanistan, people from South Central America. We've even got a few English people thrown in there as well. There are so many different ethnic groups. And our neighbors means anyone who is in need. And we know, folks, that God's message isn't just for our friends and our families and our neighbors. God's message is for the whole world to hear. And sometimes we've got to be caring for people before they care what we know. We've got to reach out with love to people before we speak the words. We're called to show love. And the Old Testament, Jesus really focused on showing love for the poor, the widow, the orphan, for good reason, because there was no social security to help them out. And in doing that, in showing love, we might then get the chance to speak about the reason for the hope that we have. So the religious leader who's challenged to view the Samaritan as his neighbor. Could we do that? Could we do that? If we were in the position of someone needing help, would we accept that challenge? Loving those, for instance, who are immigrants as we love ourselves. And that means coming to the aid when they're in need. Remember I said at the beginning, there are a lot of challenges when you move to this country. We even think of some of the challenges that we went through. And so we spoke the same language and Rachel's family lived here. It's our Christian duty, Jesus is saying, to draw alongside, to help out. Maybe there are people who need English language lessons, who need help with those forms to be filled in, help with children transitioning to school, who don't have a clue about these back-to-school children's packs that you have to take with you. And yet if the kids go to school and they don't have it, you know, don't you have to think too much to think what that kid's going to be thinking about that. And then when they come into the winter and they don't have the right clothes, again, those challenges. We've got responsibility to show the love of Jesus because we believe the gospel is the good news for everyone. And remember, you know, if you start showing love to people who are new, they may be suspicious of you. But that's not a reason why we're like, oh, well, we better not help them. They may wonder what we're doing. Now, do you remember the time when we used to send missionaries all over the world? I'm sure here at Gloria Day, we used to help finance people in different countries. Well, you know what the exciting thing is? Now all those different countries have come here. All those people have come here. Some of them even feel they now need to be missionaries here in the United States, and we need them as well. The world has come to us. And the question is, will we open the door or will we shut the door? Are we going to invite our new friends from our neighborhoods into our homes, into our lives, and into our hearts? And will we invite them into our churches as well? Remember, those who've had to flee often are followers of Jesus Christ as well. And many of them who are Christians are looking for a church to belong to. Now, we know that to start off with, the services might not be in English, but it won't be long for the kids who are growing up to want to be American, to want to speak English, to want to have Sunday schools in English. And you think Verlaine's treats are good? Taste their treats. Are we willing to invite them in and encourage them in to our churches as well? Now, last week, we had those four questions from Paul in Romans 10. Remember how he said, and how can they hear without someone preaching to them? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Come back to the feet again. God has called each one of us to have beautiful feet. And it might be our feet are the ones who are sent to places new, to people who are new, to people that we might not always go to. So may we today, may we, contrary to my feet, may we have beautiful feet. May we know that God has sent us to be carriers of his gospel, bringing the hope, bringing the joy, bringing the peace, bringing the love, bringing the forgiveness of Jesus to those that we meet. And may God open the doors for each one of us this week to go and do likewise. I invite you just to close your eyes a moment. And just as you're quiet and you feel able, pray the prayer, Lord God, please show me who you want me to be a good neighbor to. Father God, thank you for these parables that your son Jesus taught us. Parables with a meaning, often parables with a challenge. And Lord God, as we hear this parable of the Good Samaritan, we recognize it was the foreigner that help the local. Lord God, help us to demonstrate your love to those around about us, including those that we may not always think of reaching out to. Give us the strength to go and do likewise. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. On page 7, we're going to be confessing our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. And this isn't just a creed that we at Gloria Dei or in the United States say together. This is a creed that people across the world say together as they declare their faith in the God that they believe in. Please join me as we stand together if you're able to and declare our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're going to turn to prayer. I'd invite you to sit where you are, and we'll be praying together. We're going to pray, first of all, for our offerings. Thank you for the way you all give, not just with your finances, but also with your time and your talents as well. So let's turn to prayer. Father God, thank you for all that you give us. We have so much. Lord, show us how we can give to others what you have blessed us with. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Continue our prayers. We're going to pray for the situation in Afghanistan, praying for our military, and then pray for those who are sick and struggling as well. Heavenly Father, you know the fear which has gripped the nation of Afghanistan. Grant peace to a troubled region. Lead those in power to respect the rights of the people. Protect those who are unable to protect themselves. And comfort the small community of Christians in the country, who, like many others, are fearful for the future. Through Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we lift up our sailors, our soldiers, airmen, marines, and guardsmen into your loving care. Protect our nation from all that is evil. Guide our way through these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy. Turn now to pray for those people we know of who are sick or struggling. I'll just give you a few moments of quiet to lift up to the Lord those names of people that you know would need his healing touch at this moment. We pray for those people we know of. We have a list here on the back of the bulletin of people in our church and connected with our church who are also lifting up to the Lord. Father God, we pray for those who are shut in, those who are struggling to get out and get to a worshiping community. Lord, we continue to pray for the family and friends of Lorraine. Strengthen them in their mourning, Lord. Remind them of the good, happy times. May they know your peace with them. Lord God, we lift up to you, Jean. Pray for Granis. Father God, we continue to pray for Walter. We lift up to you, Millie Eckhart and Millie House. Father God, we pray for Bob and Dolores. Lord God, bring your healing to Aaron. And Lord God, we pray for Bev, you know, her struggles at the minute. Pray that they may find, the doctors may find a solution. Lord God, continue to be with Shirley in her treatment. Pray for Meridal, Lord. Bring your healing to her. We pray for Lil and Bill. And Father God, we pray for our neighbor Lil in hospital, that you may heal her. Lord God, we lift up to you Katie. Pray for Nance with her challenges. Pray for Joanne. Father God, we pray for your hand upon Kevin and all those who struggle with cancer, Dale and Amy as well. Lord God, we continue to pray for Gwen, that you may use her to reach out to her neighbors. Lord God, we pray for John and Susan. Pray for Paul. Lord God, we pray for Kathy and those who are nearing the end of life and those who have recently lost loved ones to cancer. Father God, thank you for all our healthcare workers and others who work so hard to take care of us. Lord God, we pray for your blessing upon James today. Pray for John. Lord God, we lift up to you Rudy. Pray for family members of Gwen. Lift up to you Roxy and Amy. Lord, we continue to pray for Warren and Ty. And Lord God, for all those that we have also mentioned in the quietness. Lord, in your mercy. And on page 8, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Going to turn to our communion. If you didn't pick up a pack when you came in, please come and take one now, or put your hand up, and we'll come and bring you one. And then afterwards, there is a bowl there for your leftover. After our words of institution, we always have the words, the peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you. And about this time, we would often have a meet and a greet. And we think, well, that's a good time just to go and say hi to our best buds. But remember, that time of meeting and greeting is also connected with peace, because it's a time before we receive from the Lord of the sacrament. We make up with those people that we may have fallen out with, but we may not have been so neighborly with here. So actually the time of meeting and greeting is to go to somebody you've offended and say, I'm sorry, will you please forgive me? COVID restrictions, we're going to just bear that in mind for afterwards. But I wanted just to remind us of why we say that peace afterwards. Because we're being in peace with one another as a community. Because it's in that peace with each other, other people will then see that and see our connection with each other. And as we come to communion today, we recognize that it's because Christ loved each one of us first. Gave his life for us, his body and his blood for each one of us. So we can receive from him. And then it's that example that he's shown us that we go and do likewise. So on the night before Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread. He gave thanks to God. He broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. And then after supper, Jesus took the cup filled with red wine, a reminder of the sacrificial lamb. These Israelites were strangers in the land of Egypt, but God's going to lead them towards the promised land. And Jesus took the cup and said, drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the New Testament, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins. He said to them, do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, and may the peace of the Lord be with you always,
and also with you.
So I'd invite you to take up your packs on the side with the wafer on it. Receive the body of Christ broken for you. and as we turn it over, this is the blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Will you pray with me? Father God, thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that for your love for each one of us. And Lord God, will you please now send us out as living sacrifices, having received from you, to follow your example and to love our neighbors. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to end our song by singing a great, great hymn of praise to God. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together.
Tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of the power of canceled skin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood arose for me. Look unto him, ye nations own, your God ye fallen raised. Look and be saved through faith alone. Justified by grace. See all your sins on Jesus laid. The Lamb of God was slain. His soul was once an offering made for every soul of man.
Thanks, Angie, Carmen, Meridal, and Lane around the corner. Please take your seats a moment. After the service, there'll be treats. Elaine tells me there's ice cream and other goodies as well, which is always great. So after the service, make your way inside, grab your treats, and then come out here and enjoy the slightly milder weather, which is good, and the sunshine. So we've been thinking in the service about beautiful feet. We've all got beautiful feet, even me. And so as God sends us off this morning, may we be reminded that we indeed have beautiful feet. May we know that God has sent us out to be carriers of the good news, that love, that joy, that peace, that forgiveness to those people around about us. And may we be challenged about who our neighbors are. May God have someone this week who we can bring the message of hope to. And may God the Father and God the Son, God the Holy Spirit be with each one of us, those we love and pray for, now and always. Amen.